Sometimes I feel you're trying to reach the end of a talk, and I sure hated being diverted and then having the end of the talk kind of, you know, ruined.
This is more like a workshop than it is.
Yeah, I know, but I'm thinking for both classes. Because maybe you could just have time at the end when people can come up with questions and we don't have to be afraid of being in the thing and interrupting the class.
Yeah, but I refuse that. I
know you
have people on the recording because...
But then you'd never finish your class.
Well, I would just soon have them be recorded because that's the most relevant part. When people are asking questions, they're concerned about what is going on, you know.
Yeah, but why can't they do that at the end of the class? You can still tape that.
You tape that for the sake of the other people that are going to watch the thing. They want to know what's going on, too.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It can be taped at the end of the class.
Yeah, okay.
Rather than you having to cut the class short. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I'm not saying you shouldn't allow questions.
The most important thing is when you ask your question, use as much profanity as possible. Then they'll never show it on TV.
I'm not so worried about that. It's just that I know that Richard takes 1.5 hours to do the build-up. I don't want the last, you know.
When that happens, though, that's when I move the camera
not
slower
hour
to
and
that
half.
Person.
Well, I don't know whether Julie's going to make it or no. There's a couple cars pulling up now, and I don't know if they're going to stop or no. We've got to get one last look here. I suspect she'll be late if at all.
We are running, you know.
We are.
Can't you stop running?
That's right. The same thing as dead air time on recording. All right. Last time, it was obvious that everybody had a really good time. And it was one of the better classes we've had for a long time. And the reason that it was good is because everybody participated. And the participation involved very vigorous thinking. And since I am a Virgo Scorpio, or Scorpio Virgo, depending on how you say it, I am extremely critical. And there were some aspects in the class that were not good. And there were two things in particular that were not good. The first does not apply to everyone. And it's something that makes me a little sad, and that is not that people fought, that always makes me happy, but the thinking was done in the classroom. And that means the students have been missing one of the main reasons for class, and certainly one of the main reasons for having assignments. And that is to help students to prepare themselves to work on their own. Now, I put a lot of time into the preparations for this class. And those are some of my very best hours. Because when you're all alone and you're pondering things, thoughts and intuitions come out and they really flow. And it's the best part of the week for me, usually. And so there have been these assignments for 3 years. And students have been encouraged to work on them. And every now and then, or off and on, some students have done that. And those students that have done that have found, without exception, the same kind of joy. So it's important to cultivate a life of solitude and study. Boy, I almost sound like I'm on a soapbox here tonight. But it really is important. And especially if you're going to practice astrology. Because there's not going to be any group around if you're practicing astrology, and if the group were there, it would probably be a bad thing because too many cooks spoil the soup and there's no unity to what's going on in a private session. So it's important that you get the habit of doing outside of class as much as doing inside of class. So this class is soon to be over. We only have a very few meetings left. And if you take anything from it, please take from it that you have to develop a life where you can spend time studying for the things that you're working on to help people. You can't shoot from the hip if somebody's life is involved. You have to have thought it out. Now, you all have the book, and there are all sorts of suggestions and all sorts of new handouts since the book came out. So you have plenty to work on your own. And the second thing that I'm bringing up is not as emphatic as the first. It could have been because of the instructions, they could have been written better, but most did not get the point of how specific we were trying to be. We were trying to be very, very close. It's important if you're working with someone to be able to find a very specific problem and to focus on that, and that's what we're trying to do. Now, the whole character might reinforce or dilute that problem or that talent, but we're in these exercises, we're trying to pick out something really specific. And you can do all those other things afterwards. You can look at a pattern, or you can look at a general tendency or something like that. But it's important to get right to the key issue, because the key issue is very often the thing that is most important in a person's life. Now, there are times for a general overall looking zap of the horoscope, and we will maybe do some of that yet in the times we have left. Now, we're going to go into what we did, the assignment for tonight, and I hope that doesn't dampen everybody's enthusiasm about doing this, because I certainly don't want people to not participate. That's why last week was so good. Now, for what it's worth, I don't expect much different behavior tonight, because I didn't rail last week or the last time we met, so I expect that things are going to be, hi Julie.
Hello.
I expect that things are going to be similar, especially since self-restraint and is not something that one learns very easily. Discipline is the same way. Not most people don't like discipline that way. All right. Let's look at the male horoscope this time. And I'm going to be really strict. I'm going to be really disciplined about this. So you'll have a laugh at me. And I want my strictness right down the
line.
Nervous laugh.
We're going to look at, oh, no, let's look at the female one first. All right.
Oh, now, I'm not sure I have the right packet.
Oh, there's some on the back. There's some in the back chairs.
There. Okay.
It's the one, the female with Sun in Aries and Leo rising.
Okay, let me look and see.
What did you say? Here.
Oh, here.
Oh, Sun in Aries. Yes, I do have it.
All right.
Fantastic.
All right, we'll go around and we'll ask each person what they believe the main talent that this person has. And the first time we go around, we don't want any astrological terms at all. Just what you think the talent is that the person has. All right, you want to start?
Sure. This is, the talent is an artist. Various forms of art.
Okay.
Writing, anything to do with imagination, dance.
All right.
Basically that.
Mark, what do you think?
Well, that sounds good. I'd also had possibly the capacity to teach or inspire others to transformational activities or experiences.
Okay. Ela, what do you think is the greatest talent or the most obvious?
I have no idea.
Yeah, none whatsoever. Oh, how could you? Julie?
Can you maybe come back to me?
All right, Paul?
I also had this idea of an inspirational symbol, somebody who could inspire, who could personify things like that, Eva Perón or Doris Day or somebody like that.
All right. Terry?
I don't know. I haven't looked at this enough.
Julie? Jerry?
Well, I was thinking a person might have a lot of intuition or be quite intuitive. The other thing is that they might also be very secretive so that they could be a spy.
Okay. Do you come up with something now, Jill?
No, let's just go.
I obviously have an advantage because I know who it is, but I would come up with the same thing without knowing who it is. To me, the most obvious talent is subtle persuasion. All right, now give the astrological justification for why you think the talent is what you think it is.
With my limited knowledge, because there's Neptune in Leo and the Leo rising, that's why I said what I said.
Okay. Mark?
Well, I was looking at the conjunction of the Sun and Jupiter right on the cusp of the ninth house. In fact, the Sun seems to be exactly on that cusp, and I thought perhaps that would add as somebody who could move things from the subtle, hidden factors that are so strong in the eighth house into Jupiter in the ninth, which is a more open philosophical understanding of those things. Possibly. That's what I was looking at. Anyway.
Okay. Julie?
Well, for me, the Neptune in Leo conjunct the Ascendant means that there's a lot of sensitivity kind of contained, and all of this really powerful stuff in the 8th house. So, I still don't know.
Okay, Ela?
I think it's the Venus-Mercury in Pisces.
Okay.
That's powerful.
Which has a very wide trine to Pluto.
Okay.
This is all water.
Mm-hmm.
Paul, what do you think?
One of the things that I read in Alan Leo was that when Leo is the ascendant, that whatever planet is rising there becomes the ruler of the horoscope. Mm-hmm. Do you agree with that?
Not necessarily.
Okay. Well, that combined with this, what looks like really a lot of positive, creative energy in Aries, is
okay.
Why I said what I said.
That's not a
sin. All right, Jerry, what do you got?
Well, I agree with some of what Mark says. When I first saw Neptune in the first house and that it was aspected to the eighth house, I thought that this person, quite frankly, if they weren't a spy, they would be interested in the occult. Because of the Sun being in the eighth house, and then they might try and explain that to others because of the conjunction to Jupiter in the ninth, they might try and explain that.
Okay, but you're getting way afield again. You see, this, the same thing is happening. People are looking at auxiliary things and not one simple, most concentrated thing. You're looking at the whole chart and you're looking what supports what, and that's two or three steps down the way. We're trying to look first at what is the central, most important talent, and then how that is supported or detracted from by other things.
Okay.
Julie, do you have any?
Terry.
Terry, I'm sorry.
No, I don't.
All right. I agree with Mark and Ela. I think that the Mercury conjoined Venus is the strongest aspect. I think that the Neptune on the ascendant is auxiliary, but I think it's the strongest aspect, and because Pisces is a very subtle sign, and the eighth house is a very subtle house, is how I come up with subtle persuasion, very subtle persuasion. The reason that Mercury and Venus rule persuasion is that Venus gives you loving feelings and Mercury gives you logical reasoning. And when you put the two together, that turns out to be extremely persuasive. All right.
So the conjunction does work.
Now for the third time we go through this, now we can state all of the auxiliary and the similar characteristics that support the central thing, and in this case you can use astrological justifications when you're going. All right, do you have something on this?
Mm-hmm.
No, I'm talking to
Ariel.
Ariel, yes, I'm sorry.
Well, first of all, I would have to agree with this, wouldn't I, that Mercury and Venus...
Well, no, you can support your own thesis and you can see what's auxiliary to it.
I will, because I know nothing. I just see, when I look at this, this to me is a picture. I look at it that way. This individual is a dynamo of energy. With the Leo rising and the Sun in Aries, but also what I looked at was the Sun and the Moon across from one another, and this person sort of cancels themselves out in some way. The conscious and the subconscious or unconscious, whatever you want to refer to it as. But they have a lot of energy, but they don't want to deal with some things.
Okay, but now you're a couple steps ahead again.
Okay.
We're looking at things that support your thesis. You've already said what supports it.
Okay.
So let's look at what Mark says. What do you think supports your thesis?
Well, I'm willing to support the Mercury-Venus thing, I guess.
Yeah, but what other things in the horoscope help that out, or are auxiliary to it?
Well, the trine to Pluto helps, because Pluto is in a very close square to the Sun.
Mm-hmm.
But the Mercury-Venus conjunction is trine to Pluto and therefore helps relieve that square. And probably, from my thesis, that it was that the Sun-Jupiter was a driving force, would be resisted by the square to Pluto.
Mm-hmm.
That the person would have to overcome that to express themselves philosophically or teach through Jupiter. But the fact that the Venus-Mercury is trine to Pluto would give them a good way to do that. So maybe those both work together.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Ela, do you have anything you'd like to offer?
Yeah, I was looking kind of at that, but I was looking at it from the Sun-Jupiter. I was thinking that in order to use what comes from Venus and Mercury, and since the Sun is in the eighth house, it would somehow have to use that square with Pluto to move or to to express its dynamism, as someone said, it's very dynamic. And and even though it looks, it's a very strong square, it's a subtle square, because Pluto is in Cancer, and it's not really, you can't grab hold of it. So I think that's how these work together.
Okay, Julie?
Yeah, I was looking at the square to Pluto in terms of subtlety and sort of energetic output, and that the Sun is technically in the eighth house.
And that supports the subtlety then?
Right.
By keeping the person inward.
Sort of, yes, right. The Sun is in the eighth house, and then the trine, but then I was also looking at the trine, which Mark brought up, so there's some amelioration.
The trine is much wider, though.
But the trine is exactly like that. Pluto square Sun is very tight.
Very, and Jupiter.
Yeah. Well, what do you have?
What I have is that with five mm-hmm. planets in fire, five mm-hmm. cardinal signs, that it's there's a really dynamic person, and then with the Mars, so that there's somebody with a lot of energy. And then with Mars in opposition to Neptune, is a person who I thought could literally kind of like imagine themselves into a different person.
Okay.
And that the one thing that kind of mitigates it is Saturn, which I thought could steady things a bit, and that's how I came up with the idea of maybe as a person, rather than imagining themselves to be a different person, could become a kind of icon for other people.
Okay. That's a charismatic.
Terry?
Well, I have to agree with everything so far.
Jerry?
After what some of the others have stated and what you stated about the conjunction between Mercury and Venus, all of that supports, but in a subtle way. But what also helps that subtlety out, to my way of thinking, and because I'm basing it on how Sun and Moon work in my chart, this person, because of the vacillation between those two, has the ability to look at both sides of an issue. And that combined with the other opposition on the ascendant, as Paul stated, they can come up with very unique, very subtle solutions and persuasive solutions to whatever problems they might run into, or whatever issues that they come up to, because of their ability to see both sides of an issue. That's
all right. The thesis I've been putting forward is that the strongest talent is subtle persuasion. And I based that on the Mercury-Venus conjunction in Pisces and the eighth house. Now, I think that the auxiliary things are sensitivity. If you're going to be subtle, you have to have sensitivity, and you have to be able to discriminate between one thing and another. And if you are going to persuade subtly, you want to be able to be brief. And I think that the brevity comes from the Saturn square Venus and Mercury, which I'm saying is the strongest aspect. All right, now we come to something that some of you have already been doing. Now we want to describe the potentials, what the possibilities are. In this, you can describe a scenario of how the person develops.
Cindy.
All right, Mark, do you want to describe what some of the scenarios that you see, or some of the possibilities?
Well, I already touched on the fact that I thought the person could be a teacher or inspirer.
Mm-hmm.
She would have to probably overcome, I mean, she would have to sort of live what she teached, I think, because that Pluto square the sun there means she's going to have to overcome the things she wants to express.
Okay.
I would guess.
I think that's going to be the next step.
Oh, all right.
I took this right straight from the instructions. And if you just take the instructions and look at them in almost like steps, it makes.
Well, I guess I'll pass for now.
All right, Ariel.
I seem to have lost track of the question.
The question is, in the thesis that you're supporting,
yes,
can you describe some of the possibilities or some of the potentials of this talent? Like what, you know, like you're supporting the thesis of vigorous energy. Like one thing you could support with that is maybe that this person expresses a lot of athletic energy or something like that.
Well, all I see in this chart is this: nothing will hold this woman back from whatever she wants to do. And when you use the word brevity, I have a hard time with that because what I see here is someone who could almost be short with others and sharp with others to proceed forward with all the fire that's in the chart.
Mm. Okay. But again, you're looking at the whole chart. You're not looking at one specific talent.
I don't know enough about
this. Yeah, that's why we started off from the very beginning, and this is what this is an exercise in. It's an exercise in getting one specific thing, and then now we're seeing what could have come out of that one specific ability. Hila, do you have any?
Well, I feel there's something going on with the full moon that I'm not quite getting. What I notice is there's a lot in the houses of resource.
Okay.
But I don't know that that would lead to resources.
Okay.
You know, I mean, there might actually be poverty.
Julie?
That support this town. Well, subtle persuasion and also, and brief, but also precise, because Saturn is in the fourth house, which means that she's very conscientious.
Yes.
And so she would have to sort of feel that she was saying something that she also was, which would also be supported by the Neptune conjunct the ascendant, because that's a lot of sensitivity, but it's also a lot of fragility, and because people can become physically ill if they're not in line with their conscientiousness.
Yeah.
So there's a kind of, and then Saturn's in Sagittarius and, you know, Neptune's in Leo, so there's a kind of, you know, subtle, contained, but, you know, optimism need to be sort of a force for the good.
Okay, well, you have a different thesis, and what do you think the potentials coming out of your thesis are?
Well, you know, basically, what I felt was that a person like this could become very delusional, but it didn't seem to me that this person would, because of it looked like there was enough to kind of keep it together. I mean, I basically, you know, said what I did. But I didn't really see the Mercury-Venus conjunction. I saw that as sort of an augment to the person's talents, but I didn't really see that as the outstanding feature of the horoscope.
Okay. Terry, got anything? Okay, Terry?
Well, my first impression when I looked at this horoscope was that the sun was in the eighth house. That's a secretive house. Okay, and that it was squared Pluto, which makes it even more secret, more darker. So I thought, and with the other planets sitting all in a nest there, I thought this person's talent is being quite covert and subtle. You know, subtlety is a part of coercion in a way. I thought this person could be a spy. Okay. That's the way I looked at it.
All right. I'm following on the thesis of Venus and Mercury, and since they are deposited and disposited by Neptune, and Neptune's on the ascendant, and the eighth house mm-hmm. represents threshold consciousness, mm-hmm. I think one of the potentials or possibility of this person is to bring things from realms that are normally subconscious and bring them across the threshold and into the world. A second thing that I see as a potential or possibility only for this talent is the ability to be sensitive to either nature or the environment so that it can be seen in terms of inward experience. And that inward experience is in the communication, or it's in that persuasion. A third thing that I see is that this person, with their persuasive ability, is capable of describing and communicating personal fears. Mm-hmm. Since Saturn is in the fourth house, and they can mm-hmm. give a very clear picture of what those fears are. And the final thing that I see is the ability to describe and explain insecurities mm-hmm. or dark moods or something of that nature.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Mm-hmm. Now let's look at some of the potential impediments. First, specific impediments that relate to the what you thought was the central, most important aspect in describing this. And then general impediments in the character. All right, Ariel, you want to?
I'm going to pass.
Okay, Mark?
Well, I already touched on the square to Pluto
yep.
from mm-hmm. the Sun. And I think for the Sun, Jupiter to become positively as active, she has to overcome or get the Pluto positively integrated in there. So as I said, I think she'd have to, you know, work on the things within herself first before she can express those things mm-hmm. in a positive way for other people.
Okay. Ilan?
Well, I see this T-square, which involves four planets. And one is, I mean, what I would consider a full moon.
Mm-hmm.
Which is a very heightened... which is a very heightened state of inner kind of conflict and tearing apart. And all three are in the houses of the whole thing is in the house of resources. Other than the Jupiter, so I don't know if this has to do with the struggle to provide the resources she needs to do what she must do, or if she has very powerful friends who might somehow emotionally obstruct her.
Right.
As for the moon, I'm not clear what the moon is doing there, but I know it's important because it's full moon.
Okay.
So that's as far as I've gone with that.
Are those generals or specifics?
How do you mean?
To the talent, we're talking about one talent, and you're saying that these are obstructives. Are they general obstructives, or are they specific to the talent you're speaking of?
I think they're very specific.
Okay. Julie?
Okay, I'm kind of focused on her sensitivity. I'm gonna keep thinking. Let's go to Mark.
Paul,
I'm sorry.
Well, the impediment that I saw was that it could the specifically the Sun and Jupiter conjunction could lead to a kind of excess, and it seemed to me that this was a person who would have resources.
Okay.
And that that might, you know, that I'm thinking the Moon in the second house, then that financial security is something that's going to be kind of important to this person and kind of on their mind a lot. Mm-hmm. And so that might help to damper down a little bit what I thought was really a lot of energy, especially when Uranus is involved in it.
Okay.
So I thought that would mitigate it somewhat.
All right, back to Julie. If you've had some thought time now, you got something?
Well, there's this opposition then that I'm looking at between Mars and Neptune, mm-hmm. which again maybe sort of also has something to do with this, like is would work with the square between Pluto and the Moon and Pluto and the Sun-Jupiter conjunction, something potentially about men.
Okay.
Some kind of problems with men.
You can say that on almost any woman's chart.
I suppose, huh?
Yeah.
Where there would be like this blockage with that would have to be overcome in the 11th house. Powerful, you know, but with both it kind of working against or struggling with both the Sun, Jupiter, and the Moon, which are then, you know, sort of opposite each other there. So you've got that back and forth between, you know, how she feels and what she's wanting to overcome or what she has to express and share. And then they're both squared to Pluto. So that could get in the way of articulation, just like the sort of Neptune-Mars polarity. Like it would be difficult sometimes maybe to feel the sensitivity with the pull of this action or something, or this man.
Okay. Jerry?
I think probably the biggest impediment here is fear. And it's kind of a fear of an unknown. Do you want reasons?
Mm-hmm.
A fear of the unknown caused by the Sun squared Pluto. And
you're saying the eighth house then meaning secret, and secret, another interpretation of secret is unknown.
Mm-hmm. Another interpretation, yeah, the secret unknown, and then vacillates between, well, is it this or is it that? Doesn't know what the fear is. The fear is being hidden or is deep, dark, unknown because of the square with Pluto. That's about
it. All right, I agree with everything that everybody said, but I disagree with the focus, that's all.
Mm.
Again, following the thesis that I'm following, that the greatest talent this person has is subtle persuasion. The specific impediments to subtle persuasion are something like writer's block from either doubts or from fears, which would be the Mercury-Venus square to Saturn. And since it's all tied up with Neptune, an immediate impediment would be the Neptune opposite Mars, which would indicate that this person would get ruffled.
Mm.
And it's very hard to be subtle if you're all abuzz. So I think Julie was going in the right direction when she said that. The general thing of the entire character that tends to impede would be the Pluto squares to the Sun and Jupiter, which would again not only paralyze the will as well as the specific writing talent, but it would reinforce the darkness of the other square. And what everybody has been bringing up, the ruffled quality of the Mars opposite Neptune, there are all those other oppositions to the Moon, including the full Moon, and that indicates that vacillation and indecision are general impediments in the character. Though they may not relate specifically to the one particular talent, they may be enough to distract the individual away from expressing that particular talent. All right. The last part from the instructions is to give an estimate of the likelihood of success with this talent and justify it astrologically if you like. All right. Ariel, do you have something?
Nothing can hold this woman back. That's just what I see. I have to reiterate that.
Okay. You can say what the success is, what you think from your thesis. Perfectly fine. This is not an exclusive class.
I think there's little chance of success.
Okay.
As seen in worldly terms.
Okay.
Maybe in soul growth. And, there's too many second squares, second trines. It just seems like there's some kind of unraveling going on here.
Mark, do you have any ideas?
Well, I agree there are a lot of impediments, but I think the positives are pretty positive too. So I think probably given the previous mention of the somewhat dynamic character for some aspects, also the Sun and Ascendant in dynamic signs, that the person probably would succeed in some positive success in spite of the impediments.
Okay, Julie, what do you think?
I agree with Mark.
Okay, Paul?
I think that this person will be successful on several levels.
Okay. Jerry?
Disagree. I think that this person will have a lot of good starts or good tries, but every good try will be so stymied that they will, in all likelihood, give up because of unsurety, because of indecision, because of unknowns. And there are far more tools in this horoscope that hinder than help. So if this person is, I would give a maximum 25% chance of success
in terms of numbers.
All right. You have anything, Jerry?
I agree with Jerry and Ella, because the 8th house is... It seems like it would be hard to bring it out to the open.
Okay.
Can I ask that question?
Yes.
With the Moon in the second house in Libra, does that provide some sort of a continuity with the past? So that what would hold this person, what would give this person a kick for success would be that they have a foundation laid there.
Yeah, but again, we're talking about success with this specific talent.
Right, and that's what I'm saying, that supports the success with a talent.
If the talent is what you think it is, that is a reasonable possibility. There is complementation in that. Now, in this case, when I hear what everybody says, it leads me to believe that it's a matter of experience, because several of you were looking at the whole issue of how do you tell success, and it was indeterminate. In fact, in my notes, I say that the likelihood of success I couldn't state right off because I'd have to do a complicated analysis to do that. Mm-hmm. And all of it is difficult because, as we have seen, the Saturn aspects, even though they are malefic, add something positive, because this is somebody that's capable of taking a malefic and turning it into a positive by making it be something of brevity. Mm-hmm. So instead of determining the likelihood of success, which I realized was very difficult, if not impossible in this case, I framed things in contingency.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So that to the degree that this person can put the talent in the hands of the self without being paralyzed in willpower, and to the degree that this person can avoid vacillation, to that degree she will be successful. So it's almost impossible in general to judge the success of this type of a person, because this person is a poet. And it's very hard to tell whether a poet has been successful. Mm-hmm. Individually, you can tell if the poet speaks to you and makes a hit, but it's very hard to do that. Mm-hmm. My view about it is that this earlier works of this poet were probably much better because there was less self-consciousness. And with the self-consciousness came all of the battles of will. I'm not familiar with the bibliography of this person, so I don't know what the history is like of the earlier poems or the later poems. Does anybody have any guesses who this is?
I said Emily Dickinson.
It is a person who does have great gusto, as Ariel has been pointing out, but it's also somebody that, a poet is subtle communication. Yeah. You have a guess?
I said Emily Dickinson.
Huh?
I said Emily Dickinson.
No.
No, the birth date would be right.
Yeah.
28.
Yep. Oh, there, right. I didn't even look at that.
Yeah, I just saw that April 28. I don't know who was being born.
Anybody have any guesses?
Would we know this person?
Yes. A friend of a former president.
Maya Angelou.
Maya Angelou.
This is Maya Angelou?
But this is interesting now, because she is considered successful because of the book I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings, made into a movie, and she dealt with her Saturn she spoke out about her rape, mm-hmm. and that mm-hmm. is and how she inspired other
yes.
people.
Yes.
So she
and classically Saturn square Venus is more of a aspect of rape than Pluto square Venus. So it's
So will you say that one more time?
Classically speaking, Saturn-Venus afflictions are more likely to be raped than Pluto-Venus afflictions.
And her name, Maya,
yes.
is based on her brother referring to her as Maya sister.
Oh, okay.
That's where her first name comes from.
Oh, okay. All right, let's turn to the male chart.
So, how successful was she?
She's very successful.
She's very phenomenal.
Fragility and sensitivity, absolutely.
She gets paid $43,000 minimum to show up to speak at universities. Minimum.
She's successful.
But does she speak subtle things?
She inspires. She's old
she's
now.
She's very inspired.
Maya Angelou.
Wow.
She must be 80 years old. All right, let's look at the male horoscope, and let's again be very, very strict. I don't want to be so strict because I'm afraid nobody will want to say anything if I get too strict about it. All right, let's start. And what do you think the most prominent talent person this person has? Without astrology, what do you think, just be able to put it into English, what do you think is the talent that this person has? You want to lead off, Ariel? You seem to have
yes, because
the,
I wrote a note.
Huh?
I wrote a note on this one. This person's talent is their ability to go from simplistic to complex.
Okay.
Based on...
We'll come up based on later on.
Okay.
Mark, what do you think?
Let me pass for a moment.
All right, Ela?
I haven't studied the chart. Looking at it.
Julie, what do you think?
Studying.
See, this is one of those things. Doing it on the seated by the seat
of your pants. Oh, it's awful.
If somebody comes to you and they're horribly, horribly neurotic, and you can say, I'm studying.
Hold, please, here, Candy.
Give me an hour.
This is tough.
All right, let's go to Paul, and we'll come back to Julie later.
I don't have much on this person in terms of a talent.
Okay.
I,
or just a real a character talent. It doesn't necessarily have to be a physical talent.
No. What I was looking at, and I'm not sure. I don't have too much in the way of notes, but I have very stubborn and bohemian, and someone also who could be inclined to give himself over wholly to a and this was kind of confusing.
But you're going
for,
to the general character.
Yeah, okay.
You're not going to a specific talent.
There we go.
Okay, Jerry.
Straight talk or communication, like a diplomat or something like that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. You agree? Okay.
Yes, a union organizer or something.
I agree that third house looks pretty active there. I'm not supposed to win a specific. Okay. I would say also the person may have some sort of ability to introduce radical new ideas. That break up traditions such as family or home or something like that.
Okay. Terry, do you have any ideas?
I think the person could be rather intuitive.
Okay.
The fourth house and Pisces.
All right. My notion is that the talent that this person has is patience and precision and perfection in execution. All right. Do you want to support your thesis now, Ariel?
No.
Okay.
Well, I just, look at that Scorpio rising, and I look at the sun in Capricorn, and that's where I draw my conclusions from.
Okay. Mark?
Well, my attention was drawn to the conjunction of the moon and Uranus in the fourth house. The moon there would be very much at home, I think, and would deal with traditional things such as home, family, clan, tradition, I would think, in some ways, but the conjunction with Uranus would indicate that this person might bring some new things into that complex. Being sextile to Mercury means they might be able to communicate it, although being square to Saturn might be a blockage. But I'm getting ahead of the
Julie?
There's that great trine between the Sun and Mars.
Mm-hmm.
And they're both in very in Earth signs. So Capricorn, the proper ordering of things, Virgo, very detail-oriented and critical. So there would be this great flow between some kind of understanding of relations, lateral relations, social relations from the third house into,
okay,
a public sphere.
You're
execution, execution.
Again, Paul, what do you have?
I seem to be off the mark there. Now that I hear actually some of the opinions, I think probably they are closer to the truth. The one thing that I do have is that this is someone who would focus more, who would be focused on a humanitarian efforts, but not necessarily spiritual concerns, more humanitarian efforts that have to do with some sort of say a political system or a hospital or something like that.
Okay. Jerry?
I based my communication and straight talking in that on, first of all, everything in the third house, the conjunction between the between Venus and Neptune.
But you're getting to auxiliaries again.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well,
that you're one step ahead of us. You're not doing anything wrong, but you're just one step ahead of us.
Then, what is the question again?
The question is, what is the astrological justification for what you think the specific strongest or the most specific strong talent that this person has. And you've mentioned two different things already.
Oh, okay. Well, primarily it's the relationship between the third and the third house and the 11th house. That's primarily it. Communication and universality. I mean, transparency.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
You have anything, Gary?
Maybe an educator or something to do with education, but a precise communicator, I think.
All right. My statement about patience, precision, and perfecting execution is based on the Sun trine Mars. It's the strongest aspect. It's in Earth signs,
mm-hmm.
and it's in the two most precise Earth signs, and the Capricorn part of it is very patient, and the Virgo part of it is very perfective. All right, now let's look at things that are auxiliary talents that support all of this and that reinforce this talent. No matter what your thesis is, you can bring in astrology as much as you like. All right, Ariel?
Pass.
Okay, Mark?
Well, I would agree with your determination of the main one, which would make mine an auxiliary.
Okay.
So I guess I just change its classification.
Okay. All right, Hila? Julie, you have anything?
What would support?
What auxiliary talents support this, whatever you're claiming central most talent is?
Like precision, but like brought into public view, I was like interested in. So it would be the relationship between the 11th and the 3rd house as well. And then, but then, like, because Venus and Neptune are both in Aquarius, which is so democratic, and because Mercury is in Capricorn, which would be very interested in the proper ordering of things, there would be some kind of, and then that's just, there's a drive just to, like, bring this out into, you know, the shared world through Mars, the Mars trine, the Sun, and there would be a lot of precision in that, but there would also, you know, there would be some sort of like democratic impulse. So, because I was thinking kind of political motivations or union organizer or something, almost.
Okay, Paul?
I don't have much more to say about it.
Okay. Now, what's happening with Paul is the same thing that happened last week, and it's an important thing. I'm talking about the whole psychology of this, because even though astrology describes every person, it doesn't mean that you're going to be able to pinpoint and interact with every person.
That's right.
I've done thousands and thousands of horoscopes of people, and some I draw a blank on.
Mm-hmm.
And the way I say it is that God gives me certain people to help, and my eyes are open for seeing them, and I realize at this point, even though I can see more and more all the time, I realize that I don't see all of everyone. Okay.
Well, this fellow's probably beyond my ability to help him now, 18. his troubles are over.
You talked about the Sun and Mars being the precise or preciseness of it and perfection of it. I looked at it in a different way, they would be, because of Venus and Neptune trined in, or conjunct in Aquarius in the third house, and Mercury is also just distantly conjunct to the Sun, I thought that whoever this person was, they would be able to express their views in a universal way, in a transparent way, with clarity, and yet with force.
Okay.
and get their ideas across.
Ariel had said something she wanted to say.
I thought I was just leaning on my pen.
Oh, okay.
With the sun in that third house, is there not a strong social responsibility with this individual?
I don't know.
I don't know how to support that. You know, I...
Yeah. Okay. To me, there's only one auxiliary, and that is the sextile of the Saturn to Venus and Neptune. Saturn, sextile Venus, is extremely perfecting. And Saturn, sextile to Neptune, with the Venus in there, has a visionary type of quality. And so if we're saying that perfection in execution or precision, that is reinforced doubly because of the patience of Saturn and Venus together. And so that's directly auxiliary, even though it doesn't involve the same planets. All right. Now we're looking at some of the possibilities of this talent or the compound talent that we have developed. All right, what do you think some of the possibilities are? Some of them have said already. Jerry's already said what he thinks the possibility is, that this person's going to be able to communicate. What is yours, Ariel? You have several things?
I'm passing.
Mark?
Well, the conjunction of the Sun and Venus might possibly indicate artistic talent.
Okay.
Which would lead to a certain conclusion that must probably go to the next phase.
Yes.
Hila?
So what are we looking at?
We're looking at some of the possibilities of how this talent might work out.
In the specific ones that we've mentioned, the trine and the sextile?
Or the close auxiliaries.
Well, the Saturn also squares Uranus and Moon.
Mm-hmm. But that's the next
set. That's the next set, okay.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Julie, do you have something?
Well, Uranus is sextile Mercury.
Capricorn.
Jerry, do you have more beyond communication?
I just figured it might be some sort of diplomat for some sort of government.
Okay. Paul, do you have anything?
I see him more that way too than an artist, more of either an industrialist or a politician or something like that, not an artist. One thing that I did wonder about though, and I looked in several places about this idea of Jupiter in the 12th house. You know, what is the meaning of Jupiter in the 12th house? You know, and everything I read was like, well, it could be anything. It could be anything.
Yeah. I don't want to go into something like that right now. It's
right.
Way too far afield.
Okay.
All right. My view on it is some of the things that can come out of it, and we're talking only about the talent. One is what Jerry has said, graphic communication, precise communication, objective communication, and because that Venus auxiliary is so strong there, aesthetic communication.
Mm-hmm.
Another thing is that since there is so much Saturn, both from the Capricorn and from the auxiliary, it is the ability to hold an imagination, even a spiritual imagination, until a faithful representation is communicated. Hold it long enough that it can be there. And for this person, that meant almost years. Detail. This is somebody that is capable, with this talent, of working with detail without being, without getting bogged down in detail. And part of it is an exact knowledge of materials, which comes from the earth signs, as well as from the second house Saturn. And part of that also is he knows what kind of materials or substances he needs to communicate what he wants to communicate. Some of the things that come out of here is that this may be a perfectionist, because the 11th house brings up the quality of action for its own sake. And of all things, Capricorn is a sign of stratification. And stratification played a big part in his specific talent, but that's just an add-on. Mm-hmm. And simplification. Mm-hmm. Despite the fact that there is detail, this is somebody that knows exactly which details to use without getting too far afield. You know, limitation of all the details. All right, now we're at the spot looking at specific and general impediments to development of this particular talent. All right, somebody want to lead off, Mark?
I'll pass.
Okay, Ariel?
Yes.
Eva?
Impediments to that particular talent that we've been talking about?
Yes. First the specifics.
Extreme mysticism.
What?
Extreme mysticism.
Okay. You want to explain why?
Well, because mystical visions or states are incompatible, seemingly, with precision and articulation of certain things clearly.
Okay, Julie?
They're more inward, and this implies more using the arc.
So that, are you looking at Moon?
Moon and the Uranus, yes. And Pisces.
And Pisces, yeah. And four. Right.
Okay, Julie?
Impediments to this talent. Patience and persistence.
Paul, do you have anything?
No.
Jer?
I don't know. Maybe, no, I gotta pass.
Okay.
I just don't.
Julie?
Well, now I'm looking at the opposition between Jupiter and Pluto, which is running a line across, sort of. So there's this sort of generosity towards, you know, universal solutions, and then there's like something. Pluto's in Aries in the sixth house, stops and starts.
Yeah, but that would certainly have to be a general.
Not
a specific impediment, but a general impediment. It's general to the character and not to the particular talent that we're talking about.
Okay, I see what you're saying, yes.
Yeah.
So then
all
the
right.
mysticism,
I'll
perhaps.
Tell you what I think. Since there are no problems to either Mars or the Sun, there are no specific impediments on that part.
Okay.
But since the Saturnine part, since Saturn disposes and deposits the Sun, and since Saturn is in that strong auxiliary, there is, from Saturn, something that Elo was talking about, and I interpreted it slightly different. I think that Saturn tends to repress creativity.
Mm. Oh.
He gets too focused into matter, and thinks it represses both instinct and intuition in order to be perfective. And to some extent, that then produces a repression of some of the sensible imagination. And from the same pattern, the sextile square revolving around Saturn, I think he favors one set of emotions over another.
Mm.
And perhaps that's because he's afraid of losing control and becoming hysterical or somebody like that.
Mm-hmm.
Because this is a very dignified person, diplomatic, as Jerry was saying, and is the idea of getting out of control like Uranus and the Moon would be something to him. That would be a specific thing that was always on his mind that would drive him to perfectionism. The generals, mm-hmm. I think, relate right back to this to the talents. In some ways, he can get carried away with control, perhaps because of insecurity. And it all revolves around the Jupiter opposite Pluto in the generals. He is vacillating about the use of power.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that because he has these specific attitudes about the way things are and what is important, that the Jupiter opposite Pluto is not prejudice. I think it's something like an artistic snobbishness or something of that nature, that this is proper and this is improper. Now, I don't know the man's life enough to say that, but there is something of a prejudicial attitude. Yes?
I was just going to say, the only impression I got out of it, once Hila mentioned the Uranus thing, was that he was basically afraid to go against anything that was the tried and true method.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. But he excelled at the tried and true method. All right. Now let's talk about the statement of success of this talent and justifying it, if you will. Ariel, are you passed out on this?
I passed out already.
Okay.
Okay.
Mark?
I'll pass also.
All right.
Yeah. What, in terms of
the success of this talent, yes.
Mm-hmm. The talent which needs patience and persistence.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I think he would be successful.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
He has enough Saturnine, you know, yep. in him to be successful.
Yep. Yeah, that I think so too.
Okay. Paul, you're...
What he does with that moon and Uranus.
Okay.
Right.
I would say that in this talent, and probably in general, this person has a very high possibility of success.
Yeah.
For various reasons. There's the very strong trine, mm-hmm. which is strongly reinforced. And when you have reinforcement in astrology, it makes something even stronger.
Mm-hmm.
And so that indicates that he's likely to be able to do what he wants to do.
Mm-hmm.
And he's likely to be successful because he has control. He never lets anything right. get out of hand.
He would be a very fun lover,
yeah.
but...
He doesn't want to leave anything to chance. He doesn't want to have anything to be careless. And he's likely to be successful because he knows himself. And he treats himself with caution. And he's not going to try to do something that he doesn't think he can do. And above all, for Capricorn people, he's likely to be successful because he's patient. I'll give you a quote from another famous Capricorn, Benjamin Franklin. Benjamin Franklin said, "A man who is patient can have what he wants." Period. All right, anybody have any guesses who this is? A painter.
Is it a pantalist?
Nope.
Oh.
It's a good guess.
Painter?
It's a very good guess.
He's a realist.
Who's the painter that stratified his paints and would spend months and months completing a painting? Hila should know because Rilke wrote a beautiful book about him, which I lent to somebody and I never got back. It was one of the treasures of my library.
I do that all the time.
Any guesses? I'm going to go. I just wrote to the museum in Philadelphia by email. They're extending an exhibition so that the week after Memorial Day, I can sneak out to Philadelphia and see an exhibit of him that I've always wanted to see.
Paul Cézanne,
yes.
Cézanne.
Yes.
But he's another one very successful because he bridged Impressionism and Cubism.
Yeah, but this is somebody that would think for hours before he made a stroke.
Cézanne.
You know, this is somebody really perfectionist.
I want to go with you.
What?
I want to go. To Philadelphia.
I'm going to Rosie, probably. If I go, you want to go along? We're going to sleep on the floor of...
I'm all up for a road trip to Philadelphia. Paul Cézanne. Absolutely. I love that museum, too.
I've never been to the Philadelphia
Museum. Well, they have a nice collection of...
And then there's a Rodin Museum right there, too, if you want to see
nice
that.
Nice collection of things.
There's
all
a
right.
Duchamp room.
Wow.
We have two more horoscopes again.
This is fun
time.
This way. I like this.
And I made the instructions in such a way so that it will be easier to go step by step by step before I try to force you to go step by step by step.
I didn't take
class.
Any notes today.
What's up, Bobo?
I said I didn't take
any. And we'll do it in 2 weeks again.
Which is?
Today is the first 15th, I guess.
Oh, okay.
Thanks,
Dave. See, yeah, I usually do it today. My notes. I was trying not to feel so abashed by the level of understanding.
My notes from these classes.
Yeah, I think everybody seems to like this.
Yeah, it's
yeah.
fun. Everyone builds on itself.
Despite, I was afraid of tonight's class because I was trying very hard to instill a very strict kind of discipline in order to get at specific things.
Right.
Because if somebody's having a problem, you want to get right to the root of it.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, oh no, everybody's going to balk at this and they're going to think he's become some kind of old crank or something like that, which may be true at the same time.
Well, it's the Virgoian precision.
It's
good it's though, because I'm very
time,
like gestalt, and that yeah. helps me like...
I'm curious about one thing. Why, I mean, unless you... Something like this, could that not be done every week?
No, because I'm putting a lot of time into the other, and I've got gardening to do and things
okay.
I want to do. I just don't
want
to.
Okay,
yeah.
So you just don't want to.
I just don't
want
to do that many.
Fair enough.
I'm warming you up to the fact that in a couple of years' time, it's going to be only one night a week ever, forever.
Very good. I applaud you.
It was hard looking at just one of them for in 2 weeks. I looked at that first chart and you'd have thought I didn't look at it at all. Totally.
Does Luana come Thursdays?
But I like it.
I've seen Luana since I've gotten back.
My ego doesn't like it.
Right, yeah, but what I like is the way everybody's
yes.
sees something different, but they all like sort of build on each other.
Like, what have I been struggling with you?